نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما باركت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم في العالمين انك حميد مجيد ما بعد فاني فينيشت كتاب الصلاه وذا بوك اوف ذا صلاه اند ذا نكست شابتر از كتاب الزكاه but because Ramadan is approaching so I thought of doing كتاب الصيام and if there is time we can do كتاب الزكاه later in صلى الله عليه وسلم سبحانه وتعالى give us time so we'll discuss كتاب الصيام The book of الصيام and الصيام as we know means fasting and the literal meaning of it comes from الإمساك والكف to stay away from something to hold yourself from doing something and here of course it means the religious meaning of it that الإمساك is to hold oneself away from eating and drinking and what breaks the fast from the time of Fajr till sunrise. And this is one of the pillars of Islam as we know. So let's see briefly, and again the book is very brief and very precise. For someone that wants to study matters of fiqh as a first level, and then after that getting to know things in more detail. And the masail is written, or the matters of fiqh is written for a person to comprehend it or to understand just the masala. Without getting into the details of the evidences and the differences of opinions and what is the right opinion based on the evidence and so on. So he says, al-aslu fihi, al-asl means the original status or the ruling of it, right? And the word al-asl is used by the ulama in many different meanings according to the context of the word or the sentence. So here it means that the evidence of الصيام or why الصيام is something that is mentioned in the books of fiqh. قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم الآيات. لعلكم تتقون. And then the ayat in Surah Al-Baqarah that talks about the rulings of fasting. So this is something that is prescribed upon the Muslims. This is one of the pillars of Islam. And that means he refers here to the siyam al-fard. Because siyam, like the salah, there is fard and there is nafl. There is obligation and there is optional act of worship. And the pillar of the Islam, which is to fast the month of Ramadan, it's something that is repeated only once a year for 1 month. And the pillar of the salah, of course, is every day. The salah is mandatory on everyone. As long as a person is mukallaf, he is in the age of puberty, he is a Muslim, he is not insane, right? He is not in state of forgetfulness or in state of being asleep or whatever. Salah is mandatory for him or for her at any condition, under any level, whatever a person is in. If he's not able to pray standing, he pray sitting. If he can't pray sitting, he pray laying down. He's not able to do that with his eyes, if not with his heart, that means he has to make salah. But for fasting, there are certain people that are excused, as we know, and as it's mentioned in the books of fiqh. So the original ruling that this is mandatory for every Muslim to fast the month of Ramadan, unless specified. Then he says, وَيَجِبُ صِيَامُ رَمَضَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ وَيَجِبْ, meaning it's mandatory, wajib. And the word wajib is not like what the Ahnaf or what those, the Madhhab Imam Hanifa, they separate between the word wajib and fard. Right, and the fard is more higher than the wajib, and they're both mandatory, right? And it's and the rest of the ulama, it's the same thing. So it's not a difference of opinion; it's a difference of terminology. The outcome of it is the same. So we should not think when somebody here wajib usiyam Ramadan as if this is of a lesser important than the fard. No, it means here, of course, this is fard is one of the pillars of Islam. Wajib usiyam Ramadan, the siyam of the month of Ramadan, ala kull. Meaning on the following people. Muslim, right? And this is always the issue where the ulama they talk is the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is it wajib? Is it fard on the disbelievers or no? It is mandatory for them to be Muslims to apply these orders. So al-kuffar al-mukhatabun bifuru' al-shari'ati am la. They're supposed to be Muslims to fast. It doesn't mean that it's not wajib on them, that means it's a break for them. Right? No, a person will be punished in the Day of Judgment if the message reached him, right? That he did not embrace the deen of Islam, and as a result of that, did not fast the month of Ramadan and did not do what is halal and to stay away from what is haram and so on. So, but it's of course in the ahkam of the dunya, of course, a person has to be a Muslim. So if someone wants to, he loved the matter of fasting, he finds it very interesting, very spiritual. They want to fast. They can do that, but it's not fasting, right? They're abstaining from food and drink and so on, but they're not fasting. They're fasting in the religious sense. A person has to be a Muslim doing that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, following the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Baligh, right? He has to be reach the age of puberty. This is mandatory. When we say here the shurut al-wujub, these are the conditions for something to be mandatory. He has to be reach the age of puberty. But if someone fasts before the age of puberty, a child did not reach the age of puberty yet, and he fasts, his fast is valid, and he gets the rewards of this. And his parents get the reward also, right? But it's not mandatory on him. So there's difference between, as the ulama differentiate between shart al-wujub or shart sah, the conditions of wajib, mandatory, and the condition of the validity of the act. A child prays, his salah is valid, he gets rewards for it. He makes hajj, his hajj is valid, he gets rewards for it, but he has to make the hajj, of course, after the age of puberty. But as far as the wujub, the mandatory thing, it has to be by the age of puberty. Does that mean that we do not order our children to fast till they reach the age of puberty? No. As the salah, the Prophet ﷺ said, مُرَ أَوْلَادَكُمْ صَلَاتِ وَمَنَّا وَسَبَعَ. You order your children to pray when they're 7 years old. The same thing with the different orders of the deen of Islam. If they misses it, no punishment for them, because they're not yet responsible. But it's the responsibility of the parents. The parents, as some of our ulama would say, they're the one that will be held accountable if their children did not perform the duties that they're supposed to perform when they reach the age of puberty. So it's a matter of upbringing, and for them to get used to it. And as it's mentioned in the hadith, where they used to, sahabiyat used to get the children to fast, and when they ask for food, even the very young ones, when they ask for food, they would make them busy with toys and things like this to get them busy so that they don't think or ask for food. But again, this is not to torture them, but this is to get them used to fast, so that once they reach the age of puberty, it's part of their norm, not something that they would struggle with. So Muslim, baligh, aqil. Aqil meaning that he is sane, right? He's not insane. If a person is not responsible for his actions, there is no duty on him whatsoever. So, عاقل قادر على الصوم. قادر على الصوم. قادر means capable, have the power, have the means to fast. So this is a condition to make it wajib. If he's not able, then fasting is not mandatory on him, unless because it's abstaining from food and drink, which is one necessities of one's life. So if a person is not capable, then who would who would determine who is qadr? It depends on what the situation of the person. Of course, there's the normal excuse, traveling, whatever. But when it comes to health-wise, it has to be either something that is well-known, or a person really cannot do that, he would faint, he would pass out, or whatever. Or a Muslim doctor that knows the importance of fasting. So for someone who is not really sure, should he fast or not? So he asks a non-Muslim doctor, right? Can I fast from Fajr to Maghrib? You say, you're crazy, don't you ever do it, right? Then he's not to ask that, because he doesn't understand what fasting and what's the level of fasting, how important it is. So to ask a Muslim doctor, and not any Muslim doctor, a Muslim doctor, he's Muslim, but he's not really, you know, he's not very strong in the deen, right? Someone that knows the importance of fasting, and then he would give the right answer if the person is not sure. So قادر على الصوم برؤية هلاله أو إكمال شعبان 30 يوم. Another, the fifth Tengir mentioned is بِرُؤْيَةِ هِلَالِ. When does Ramadan mandatory for people to fast? بِرُؤْيَةِ هِلَالِ. When people see the hilal, the crescent or the moon of Ramadan. Or إِكْمَالِ شَعْبَانِ 30 يَوْمًا or شَعْبَانِ, the month before Ramadan, is 30 days. Because the month cannot be 31 days. So even if they didn't see the moon, but the month of Sha'ban is 30 days, then the next day, automatically, without having to see the moon, is the first of Ramadan. So these are the two conditions. And the Prophet said, قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَأَفْطِرُوا فَإِنْ غُمَّ عَلَيْكُمْ فَقْدُرُوا لَهُ. Hadith متفقٌ عليه بخاري مسلم. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا. Very clear hadith. And this is the issue that repeated every year, which that particular issue with regarding to the moon and the people differences of the Muslims are split with the matter of the moon, it's by itself to show it's more deeper than just the sighting of the moon. It shows that those who would follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ and those who would follow their desires and they think that they know better than the way the Prophet ﷺ said. No Muslim would say that with his tongue, right? But sometimes the actions are louder. And this is a very important issue that we have to make it very clear. Prophet ﷺ, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, that we get our deen from him, ﷺ, he said in a clear statement, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُ. If you saw it, right? Meaning the hilal, فَصُومُ, then fast. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَأَفْطِرُوا. And if you see the hilal, فَأَفْطِرُوا, break your fast, meaning at the end of the month of Ramadan. فَإِنْ غُمَّ عَلَيْكُمْ, إِنْ غُمَّ عَلَيْكُمْ, if it was hidden from you, there was غَمَام, it was cloudy, you could not see the crescent, the moon, فَقْدُرُوا لَهُ. فَقْدُرُوا لَهُ can mean two things, which is a very different of opinions. فَقْدُرُوا لَهُ means you make your judgment, right? You count for it, right? Or in the other meaning, that means you complete the month than 30 days, right? That means you complete the month 30 days. You did see the hilal. That means you the next day is Sha'ban, and then the following day is Ramadan. وفي لفظ فقدروا له 30, right? So the other narration explains it. That means make it 30. Make the month of Sha'ban 30 because you did see the moon. If it's hidden by the clouds, does it mean that the hilal is not there? It might be there, right? So scientifically, right, the next day might be Ramadan. But the deen says, if you didn't see it, then the next day is Sha'ban and not Ramadan. So the Prophet said, if people take a helicopter and go over the clouds to see it, right, this is not something for them to do. There's no need for them to do this. This is not about scientifically proving by precise decisions that this is the month of whatever, right? It's the deen is simple. The deen of Islam fits any community under any condition. Whether people are sophisticated and they think that they know better and they have calculations and all that, or whether people are in the jungle or in the desert. Everybody can fast the month of Ramadan and everybody can fulfill the duties of the deen without having the need of any form of sophistications or complexities and so on. So if first the normal ruling here, if they cannot see it, then the next day is 30 days. وفي لفظ فأكملوا عدة شعبان 30, رواه البخاري. And if فأكملوا meaning complete the counting of شعبان to be 30. ويصام برؤية عدل لهلاله ولا يقبل في بقية الشهور إلا عدلا. To start the month of Ramadan, right, ويصام meaning that for the majhul here, that means fasting for the month of Ramadan. People would fast the month of Ramadan بِرُؤْيَةِ عَدْلِ, by the sighting of one just person, one only. He has to be عَدْلِ, just. Just meaning that he is not someone that known to be a liar or something like that. وَلَا يُقْبَلُ فِي بَقِيَةِ الشُّهُورِ إِلَّا عَدْلًا. The rest of the months, including شَوَال, meaning at the end of the month of Ramadan, the witness of one is not enough, it has to be two people. So the rest of the months of the year, two people to witness, not one. But if one, only one person comes for the witness of the beginning of the month of Ramadan, that's it. The whole Ummah would fast. He didn't mention some of the things here. which is a valid also differences of opinion, which is can people fast with the sighting of one only in their locality, or the whole ummah would fast by the sighting of one. This is a valid differences of opinion, right? The qadid of al-matala' or the different sighting of the moon, right? This is a valid differences of opinion. The jumhur, the majority of the ulama are in the opinion that if one Muslim sees the moon of Ramadan, then all Muslims should fast, right? All Muslims, no difference. But they, some said, as if they share part of the night or part of the day, right? So that means everybody would fast. This is the majority of the ulama, and this is what should be done. The other opinion, which is a valid opinion, has the hadith of Ibn Abbas. We're not going to get into the details of this. If each locality has its own sighting, each locality has its own sighting, which is also fine. So if people choose to do this, that's fine. So it's not about the disunity of the Muslims. Some people would say, but it doesn't make sense that the people here in this area would fast and then other places, same locality, meaning, for example, say there is no communication. People in St. Louis, they didn't see the moon and they didn't fast. That's fine, right? But the point is, it's not about the Muslims being disunited. It's about following the way of the Prophet ﷺ. That's why, you probably heard that before many times, this thing that the people follow, which is the calculation, when people follow calculations, this is falsehood. This is deviation. This is not permissible, right? This is against the deen of Islam, right? And this is consensus among the ulama. It is not permissible to follow al-hisab al-falakay. It is not permissible to follow calculations for the beginning of the month or the end of the month. So for those who already decided that the first of Ramadan is whatever, July 7th or whatever there is, then this is something else. This is not the deen of Islam. There's no such a thing, right? The Prophet ﷺ, and I won't spend so much time on this point, but this is something that has to be, it's not a debative issue, it's finished, it's something that is done. If somebody debates with you with that, we have text versus what people think and what people like. The matter is finished, we follow the text, we follow the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, we don't follow what makes sense to us. And the arrogance comes in place, we're sophisticated now, we know things, we know exactly when the moon will be born and all of these things, mashallah, good for you. But the deen is something else. This is not deen. This is, you do that in your lab. It's not about the moon being born or not. It's about seeing the moon or not. If you don't see it, that's it. This is how easy the matter of the deen is. Before saying the hadith, we know that if someone witnessed the act of zina, wal'iyadhu billah, right? He witnessed the act itself, and he is one. And he goes to the judge or whatever, and he says that I saw this. What's the ruling for that purpose, for that person? He saw it. He's a just, he's the head of all the ulama of the world, for example. And he would never do this, of course, if he is the head of the ulama, if he's a alim. He goes to the judge and he says, I saw this man and this woman committing zina, and exactly the same act with all what it means. That witness, he will be lashed 80 lashes. Well, he saw it. If two people come, they also will be lashed. If three, they saw this, they will be also lashed. It's only four, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so difficult for people to witness the act of zina, for the punishment. He made it so, made it difficult for the punishment of zina to be established by witnessing, unless a person comes and confess, right? Four to witness the act. Where is that? This is something that is very difficult, correct? And he made the whole ummah to fast the month of Ramadan by the witness of one man to the moon. Allah is the most wise, right? So what happened when people sometimes they make it difficult for themselves when the deen is so easy? The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, نحن أمة أمية حديث البخاري and others, نحن أمة أمية, we are illiterate ummah, لا نقرأ ولا نحسب, we do not read, we do not calculate, right? الشهر هكذا وهكذا, and the Prophet ﷺ pointed with his finger, the month is like this and like this. He pointed either 30 or 29. Right? Prophet ﷺ was talking about what? About Ramadan, about fasting. He says we are illiterate ummah. Right? This is in the context of being proud of this ummah. It's a praise to the ummah, or illiterate ummah, that means we're not very educated. No, this is praising the ummah. It's not praising the fact that we cannot read and write. That means we should stay like this, like some understood this hadith and say, but now we know. We have the education, we have the knowledge, so we should then do otherwise. The Prophet ﷺ meant here at the time when Ummah was illiterate. No, the Prophet ﷺ is stating a fact to this Ummah till the Day of Judgment. That means this is a praise. It means this Ummah, when it comes to matter of its deen, does not need any other thing other than what's in the deen of Islam. Because it's such a universal way of life that doesn't need a PhD for someone to figure out how to start the month of Ramadan. Right? You go to the jungle somewhere, you can still fast. You won't miss anything. Right? If you're very well educated, you can still fast. So this is what it means. It's in the context of praising this Ummah. Right? That the matter is so easy. We do not need these types of things to establish our deen. Doesn't mean that we don't need these things, of course we need it, but in other things. But to establish the deen, you don't have to be knowing these things. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said the month is like this and like this. So people say, but what if the, and many times it happens, people fall into mistakes and countries make mistakes, so what? It happened at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, it happened at the time of the early generations of Islam. Are we better than them? We're better than them. If it happens as a mistake, people didn't, you know, they realized that they, at the end of the month of Ramadan, they saw the moon in the night of the 29th. That means they only fast 28 days of Ramadan, which is of course not permissible. Then what happens? They just make up a day afterwards and that's it. But they need to still follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ. Not that, oh, we missed it because we followed the naked eyes sighting of the moon. Next time, inshallah, we will go by the calculation. No, this is deviation. It's valid to happen this way because it's not about being precise and correct. It's about following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Plus the calculation till now can never be 100% precise. Because the calculation does not talk about the sighting. It talks about the moon when it's born. Is it correct to say born? So they calculate when the moon will be there. But it can be there, but you can't see it. Can't see it, this is something that calculations cannot be exactly precise to the highest level of precision. Because it's human eyes, right? You cannot be precise with this. You can say the moon will be formed at that time and that specific second, mashallah. It can be formed, yes, but people cannot see it with their own eyes. So it's not Ramadan yet. So it's not about the calculation when the moon will be formed. It's about seeing the moon. So moon ru'yati. The statement cannot be more clear than this. The Prophet ﷺ said, did not say sumu or fast when the moon is there. Right? Sumu, fast when you see the moon. Right? So hopefully this is something that we should not be deceived by this. But if people differ among themselves whether to follow this country or that country or local, that's fine. Then people should follow whatever is present in their locality. If they decided that they follow whatever the locality that they're in, they're not doing any bid'ah or any innovations or anything like that. But especially in America here, since Muslims do not have an authority, right, then they should follow the majority of the ulama. If the moon is sighted somewhere, right, and we share a part of the night with them, fast. It's not a political game. It's not an issue, oh, we shouldn't, I heard, you know, sometimes people say we should not depend on these people overseas and things like this. If Muslims see it, that's it, that's the end of it. Anyway, so this is the issue with Ru'yatul Hilal, or seeing or sighting the moon of the month of Ramadan. Then he says, وَيَجِبُ تَبْيِيتُ النَّيَّةِ لِصِيَامِ الْفَرْضِ. The next mas'ala here, or issue, the niyyah of siyam al-fard, the intention, which is one of the pillars of fasting. Fasting has two pillars. First pillar is the niyyah, intentions. The second pillar is to abstain from what breaks the fast. So the niyyah says wayajib. It's mandatory. Tabiitu al-niyyah. Tabiitu al-niyyah meaning that you have the niyyah from the night for the fard siyam. وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ. Those who would spend the night, so jadal wa qiyam. So the same word is used, tabiit, that you do it before fajr. And this is one of the issues also, there's differences of opinion. But the point here, if it's siyam wa fard, if it's fard the salah, then fard the fasting, that means you have to have the niyyah before fajr. Is it one niyyah for the whole month, or it's one every day has its own niyyah? Differences of opinion. Correct to be Allahu A'lam, it's for every night of every day of the Ramadan, you have to have the intention that you would fast that day. What does it mean to have the intention? Intention is not to say نويت أن أصوم غدا اليوم كذا. You don't say I have the intention. This is not intention. You don't say it with your tongue. You don't even say it with your heart. You don't stop and focus and do this. No, there's no such a thing. Intention meaning إرادة الفعل. You know that you're going to do this. So since you know that tomorrow is Ramadan, that's it, that's your intention. But why the intention, why the difference then if it's every day or the whole month? It has significance to it. Why? Because imagine someone slept before Fajr in any day of Ramadan. And he woke up, he slept before Maghrib. Right? Before Maghrib he slept, and he woke up after Fajr. He woke up after Fajr. Can he then fast and count this day? According to their opinion, no. Because at any time during the night, he didn't have the intentions to fast. He was not there during the night. He was sleeping. Right? So in that case, he should continue to fast so that he does not break his fast because of the month of Ramadan. But he has to make up that day. Because he did not have the intention during the night. So the intention meaning, if you're a Muslim and you know that you are in Ramadan, and you are awake at any part of the night of Ramadan, you have the intention. Because you know that the next day is Ramadan, and you know, you're fasting, you eat suhoor, you know, so you don't have to do anything. You don't have to go out of your way. You don't have to remember to say something so that after Fajr you say, oh, I didn't make my niyyah. There's no such a thing. Right? It's something in your heart. If somebody asks you during the night, in any line of Ramadan, are you fasting tomorrow? You're going to look at him like this. That means, yes, of course I'm fasting tomorrow. That's the intention. But do you have to have somebody to ask? You know. So you understand the issue of the niyyah. It's like when you go to the salah. You came to make Salatul Maghrib. Right? You don't have to say, of course this is not from the sunnah to say I have intention to pray Salatul Maghrib. It's not by the tongue, it's not even by the heart in the sense that you would make your heart whisper to yourself. No, you know that you're coming, you know, to the masjid. Otherwise, people claim to be insane really. If they don't know what they're doing, right, this is insanity. You're coming to the masjid to pray Maghrib. You're not coming to the masjid to do something else. This is your intention, that's it. Right? So that's the importance of the niyyah during the night for everything. وَأَمَّا النَّفْلُ فَيَجُوزُ بِنِيَّةٍ مِنَ النَّهْرِ. As for the nafl, for the optional fasting, فَيَجُوزُ, it's permissible, بِنِيَّةٍ مِنَ النَّهْرِ, to make the intention during the day. If it's a nafl siyam, if it's a nafl fasting, so the nafl is easier. Meaning that you're not thinking about fasting whatsoever, and you are in the morning after Fajr, and all the way as the Ramadan say till Dhuhr, right? You didn't eat anything or drink, and he's like, let me fast today. Sure, no problem. Right? This is valid. You don't have to have the intention from the night, but with the condition, of course, you didn't eat or drink anything after Fajr. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ did. He would go after Fajr, he would go to his home after sunrise, and he would ask, is there any food today? Right? If they would say no, right, he would not start, this is a fight, to say, what do you mean there's no food today? No, he would say, then I'm fasting today. Right? So he would fast, alayhi salatu wasalam, the nafl salah, in the morning having the intention to do that. So this is easy when a person wants to do the nafl siyam, but not the fard. And not the fard meaning if a person is making up the fasting of Ramadan, he should have the intention from before fast. وَالْمَرِيدُ الَّذِي يَتَضَغَرُ بِالصَّوْمِ وَالْمُسَافِرُ لَهُمَ الْفِطْرُ وَالصِّيَامُ. Now with the exceptions, المريض, the sick person, الَّذِي يَتَضَرَّرُ بِالصَّوْمِ. Not every sick person can break his fast. It's the sick person, الَّذِي يَتَضَرَّرُ, meaning from الضَّرَر, the one that is harmed by fasting. So the person is sick, but fasting doesn't harm him. I'm not sure exactly what. But if the sickness does not harm him, then he still have to fast. But if the sickness would harm him or increase his sickness, Allah knows best, but according to the means, he might be able to fast, but more likely that his sickness will increase. Then he is falling into this category that he is harmed by fasting. One musafir, and the traveling person with no other thing but just the fact that he's a traveler. So if he's traveling in air conditioning in a very luxurious way, no tiredness, no nothing, he still can break his fast. He has this rukhsah, he has this break that he can break his fast. لهم الفطر والصيام. They can break their fast and they have to make up the day. So with the issue of the musafir, the traveling person, what is better for the traveling person? There's no such a thing. A person can break his fast and it's not less preferred. A person can fast and it's not more virtuous. And as the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, laysa min al-bir, al-siyam, al-safar, it is not out of righteousness that a person would fast while traveling. Meaning that don't think that when you're traveling and you fast, you get more rewards because of your traveling and fasting. No, if you fast, mashallah, this is good, you fasted a day of Ramadan. But if you don't fast, it's absolutely fine. But as the ulama they say, if it's whatever easier for the traveler, this is what is close to the sunnah. If it's easier for the fast, sometimes the traveler, it's easier for him to fast. Right? Because everybody's fasting, for example, it's easy for him, he's used to fast in Ramadan, he doesn't want to make up the day later, right? Something like this. So that's easier for him to fast, so this is what's closest to the sunnah. It's easier for him to break the fast, and he would make it up later. Then break your fast. Don't make it difficult for yourself if you're traveling. But al-hila fil Islam mamnu'a, that if a person is traveling intentionally so that he breaks his fast, that's not permissible. Playing tricks is not permissible. But a person should not prevent himself from traveling. If he has to travel, he travels and he can break his fast. Even if he's going for Hajj, for Umrah, right? And people sometimes in the airplane, especially if it's close to Mecca or something, somebody from, you know, the flight is 2 hours or 1 hour, and even the airlines, sometimes they don't give food for the people when they usually do, right? And they think everybody's fasting. But if somebody doesn't want to fast, right? And if somebody eats and they're making the haram and everything, people look at him like he's doing something very evil, right? It's his right, he can do that, he's traveler. And he should not be looked bad, or you think that you're better than him, and you'd say, you know, he would say, it's easy, as if you're just, it's more comfortable than your home. Why are you breaking your fast? He has the right, right? And anyway, especially also if a person is going for Umrah, right? And if he fasts, he would not be able to perform the Umrah in the proper way. Which is now the priority here, is to fast, and he's a traveler, or to do the Umrah. A person has to weigh the benefits and the losses here. He's making Umrah maybe once in his life, right? He should make the Umrah in the perfect way, and he has the excuse to break his fast. So that he does not fast and he do the Umrah, and he can't wait till it's finished. Right? And he's not making Umrah really in the proper way. And as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when they were traveling, and some of them they were fasting and some of them were not fasting, and it was a very hot day, right? And when they rested for a while, and those who were not fasting, they put the tents together and they, you know, served those who were fasting, and those who were fasting, the hadith says they fell on the ground out of tiredness. The Prophet ﷺ, after that, he said that ذهب المفطرون اليوم بالأجر. He said those who are not fasting, they surpass the fasting ones today with the reward. They get more rewards, right? So it's very important to know the levels of the deeds. And that comes, of course, by asking the people of knowledge. But anyway, so traveling is one of the excuses to break the fast. And he has to make up the day. وَالْحَائِضْ وَالنُّفَسَاءِ يَحْرُمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الصِّيَامُ وَعَلَيْهِمَ الْقَضَاءِ الْحَائِضْ وَالنُّفَسَاءِ, the woman and her menses, and after birth bleeding, يَحْرُمُ, it's haram for her to make fasting, to fast, it's haram for her. وَعَلَيْهِمَا الْقَضَى, and both they have to make up the day. Right? So it's haram for her to fast. Some said if a woman, for example, in her menses, can she, you know, during the day of Ramadan have a feast, right, and eat and so on, or she should respect the month and so on, and she's not fasting, but she should be moderate when it comes to breaking her fast. And she should be careful, for example, in front of her kids, for example, if they are being trained and they're small, and trained to fast, not to do that in front of them. But it's, you know, she's not fasting, so she should not fast or not eat and drink and think that this is better for her. وَالْحَامِلُ وَالْمُرْضَعُ إِذَا خَافَتَا عَلَى وَلَدَيْهِمَا أَفْطَرَتَا وَقَضَتَا وَأَطْعَمَتَا عَنْ كُلْ يَوْمِ مِسْكِينٍ. Now the wording of al-hamil wal-murda'. Al-hamil is the pregnant woman, and al-murda' is the one that is breastfeeding. They can break their fast and they make it up, but here with a condition. إِذَا خَافَتَا عَلَى وَلَدَيْهِمَا, if their fear for the health of their child, then they can break their fast, right? So the one that is pregnant or breastfeeding, there is one of two conditions here. Especially the pregnant, she might fear for her own life, right? and she can feel for her child. If there is danger on her, then she can break her fast. Again, by the a Muslim doctor would say this. And if there is a fear for the child, she can break her fast. The same thing with the breastfeeding. Usually, the danger is for the child. If there is, you know, he won't be fed, then she can break her fast and she make up the days. وَأَطْعَمَتَ عَنْ كُلْ يَوْمِ مِسْكِينَ. Here he's taking the opinion that she makes up the day that she broke the fast, and feeding for every day a poor person. And who is to feed? Is it the husband or the guardian of the child or the woman? If she broke her fast because of the child, right, they say it's the husband or the guardian, because she broke her fast for his child, not for her. If it's for her own health, then she feeds the poor and she make up the day, right? So this to be away from the differences of opinion, she would make up the day and feed for every day, especially if the next Ramadan comes and she didn't make up the days. So because women, when usually they, when they're young and, you know, they're pregnant or breastfeeding. So 1 year she's pregnant, the next year she's breastfeeding. So the first year she didn't make Ramadan, fast of Ramadan, so she has 30 days. And then the next year she was not able to make up the days throughout the year. Then the next Ramadan comes in place, right? And then she's breastfeeding, she can't fast this month, right? So she has like 60 days or sometimes more, right? So if the next Ramadan comes and she didn't fast these days that she broke her fast in, then she would feed for every day a poor person and still count the days. Till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy, she can make up these days, Mondays and Thursdays or whatever, right? So this is for the pregnant woman and the one that is breastfeeding, she has the excuse to break her fast. وَالْعَاجِزُ عَنِ الصَّبْرِ. The other, also one that is excused, الْعَاجِزُ عَنِ الصَّبْرِ, the one that is not capable of fasting, لِكِبَرٍ أَوْ مَرَضٍ لَا يُرْجَبُ لِكِبَرٍ, because of old age. So old age by itself is an excuse. The very old age, that the person does not have a specific illness, but the weakness that comes with old age, he's not able to fast. He would faint, you know, things like this. Then he's excused. Or marad, or sickness or illness, la yurja burhu, that means he has no hope for it to be cured, the permanent disease, right? In that case, فَإِنَّهُ يُطْعِمُ عَنْ كُلْ يَوْمٍ مِسْكِينَ, that he would feed for every day a miskin, a poor. He does not have to make up the days because it's Allah knows best, but these types of diseases or illnesses, there's no cure to it. Although if Allah cured him, that's a different situation, he has to make up the day. But the original ruling is that he would pay for every, or feed for every day of home. Say feed, not money. So it's not money that you give to the poor, it's not valid. It does not validate it, it has to be feeding a poor, right? So again, we should not use what we think makes sense. You know, the poor person doesn't need food, right? Not to do money, right? Either you feed him a meal, that if you feed him the meal, he will be full, doesn't want to eat till the night, till he goes to sleep. Or you give him, you know, something like, you know, some a bag of rice, 1 kilo, or you know, whatever the weight of rice. It doesn't have to be cooked or anything that is not, can be saved. So either cooked food that they would eat, or you know, food that they can save. And a person can wait till the end of the month and feed 30 people, you know, as a result of that. Not one person, but for every day, a miskin, one poor person. He can give money to something, somebody, an institution, a person, that they would feed the poor. But it has to reach the poor as food. Has to reach the poor as food. وَمَنْ أَفْطَرَ فَعَلَيْهِ الْقَضَاءُ فَقَطْ. And the one that after, meaning he broke his fast, whether it's intentional, of course, if he did that as a sinful act, فَعَلَيْهِ الْقَضَاءُ فَقَطْ, meaning he has to just make up the day only. But the one that broke his fast, right, intentionally as a sinful act, or he made a mistake and he has to make up the day, he just make up the day. But the one that intentionally breaks his fast and as a sinful act, some of the ulama, they say he is not even to make up the day. Why? Because making up the day is like as if it's expiation of the sin. No, it's not expiation of the sin. If a person, that person fasts his whole entire life afterwards, it would not make up for the crime that he committed, and that is to break the fast in one day Ramadan. So what's the expiation of this? It's tawbah. It's to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no expiation in actions except tawbah. But to make up the day, yes, to make up the day, but this is not an expiation of the sin. Person should not think, okay, he broke his fast in Ramadan, I just make up the day and he's fine. No, it's tawbah that what expiates the sin. And if he fasts the whole life, it would not be enough for breaking that fast of that day, because this is fard. And that's why the siyam of Ramadan, the fasting in the month of Ramadan, this is fard compared to the nafl. If a person fasts all of the year, is not equal to the reward of fasting one day of Ramadan. That's why Ramadan is not an easy thing. The reward that is given, and that's why fasting during the month of Ramadan and being conscious and while fasting and the night prayer and so on, something that the reward can never be comprehended whatsoever, because this is fard. So, من أفطر فعليه قضاء فقط the majority of the علماء that he has to make up the day, but what expiates the sin is the repentance. إذا كان فطره بأكل أو شرب أو قيء عمدا. If his breaking the fast was as a result of eating or drinking, أو قيء عمدا, intentionally vomiting. If a person vomits during his fasting, does not break the fast. إذا غلب القيء, if he overcome by throwing up, it does not break the fast. What breaks the fast is intentional vomiting. If he intentionally vomit, and it doesn't have to be a sinful act, a person might took something, poison for example, or something, and he has to vomit this, right? If he's ordered to vomit because he has something harm in his stomach, then he should do that, and there's no sin on him, but he has to make up the day. But if you do it as a sinful way, of course, then this is a sin. أو حجامة. The hijama has differences of opinion, and that's why it should definitely be avoided in Ramadan. Because some said it's abrogated, some said it's not. So, hijama should be avoided in Ramadan. But Allahu A'lam, the correct opinion, hijama does not break the fast. Hijama does not break the fast, but to be away from the differences of opinion, a person should stay away from it. أو إمناء بمباشرة, or ejaculation. Right? بمباشرة meaning intentional. Right? Whatever means intentional is. Right? But if a person slept and he had a wet dream, that does not break the fast. So if a person out of sleeping or unintentional, then it doesn't break the fast. But if it's intentional by his own act, whether it's a sinful act or halal act in other than Ramadan, right? It breaks the fast, and of course this is a sinful thing. And a person in that case, he would have just to make up the day and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except إلا من أفطر بجماع. If it when it's time for the then please go make an adhan. Don't wait for me to finish. When it's time for the then immediately make the adhan. إلا من أفطر بجماع. Except the one that أفطر or break his fast بجماع as a result of intercourse, having relations with his wife. فإنه يقضي ويعتق رقبة. This is the case where it has the قضاء and the كفار. So the قضاء only. Right? Is for everything else. When is the qada? Because some people think that if a person intentionally broke his fast, he has to make the qada and the kafar, the expiation, freeing a slave and so on. No, it's only for the one that has sexual relations. This is the one that has to do the qada and the kafar. So the qada is to make up the day, then ويعتق رقبة, to free a slave. فإن لم يجد, if he can't find a slave to free, which is the case nowadays, فصيام شهرين متتابعين. To fast two consecutive months. متتابعين. Meaning that if he breaks his fast any time in the middle, he has to repeat the whole 2 months again. If he breaks his fast the last day of the 2 months, he has to repeat the 2 months again.
Continuously.
No breaking whatsoever between the 2 months. 2 months, of course, with the lunar, right? So it has to be 2 months.
This for what? For breaking
the fast with sexual intercourse.
Intention.
Yes. فصيام شهرين متتابعين. فإن لم يجد أو فإن لم يستطع. If he's not able to do this, فإطعام 60 مسكينا, then he has to feed 60 poor people for every day. 60 poor people. But it's an order like this. Not that he choose. No, if he can't free a slave, then fast 2 consecutive months. If he can, then he would feed 60 poor people. Some people might think this is a more difficult expiation than the one intentionally break his fast. So this is an easier one. Like when you compare, which is worse as a sin? For someone to break his fast with having relations with his wife during the day of Ramadan, or to eat and drink intentionally. Both are evil acts, of course, right? But which is more evil? Is to eat and drink.
Eat and drink.
Eat and drink. A person, if something overcome him, for example, and he had this, when you find that expiation means what? That if he does this, the sin is forgiven. But when there's something that has no way out except the repentance, this is more difficult. You see what I'm saying? Because there's nothing to expiate it except the sincere repentance, and his whole life has to change, and he has to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the ayah about those who kill and commit zina and so on, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, except for those who repent and do righteous good deeds and so on. But this is again, of course, to show the sanctuary of the month of Ramadan. That if someone during the day of Ramadan commit this evil act, even with his wife, this is such an evil thing.
What about woman? She cannot fast 2 months consecutive.
If a person cannot fast 2 consecutive months, then to feed 60 poor people. If a person can't feed then 60 poor people, then he is excused. And there is in this the famous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, O Prophet of Allah, I'm destroyed and perished. So the Prophet ﷺ told him what? He said, I waqa'tu ala ma'ati fi nihal Ramadan. Waqa'tu means, and this is the polite, in Arabic you don't have to go through the very, you know, difficult words, which means I fell on my wife during the month of Ramadan, right? Of course it's understood. So the Prophet ﷺ did not tell him, woe to you, you criminal, you fasted, you kafir, right, or you're a sinner. Imagine someone comes to us, and this is the etiquette of, you know, someone comes to us and says this, see, astaghfirullah, how dare you, brother, you know? It's already happened, right? The Prophet ﷺ told him, can you say it? Can you free a slave? He said, I can't. He was poor. Can you fast 2 consecutive months? He said, I can't. He said, can you feed 60 poor people? He said, that wallahi, O Prophet of Allah, baina al-bataya, between the two limits of Al-Madinah, there's no one poorer than me. Right? So the Prophet ﷺ asked the people, anybody has anything? So it was brought to the Prophet ﷺ a basket or a bucket of dates. So the Prophet ﷺ, actually the man did not say the statement yet. He said, I cannot afford to feed 60 poor people. So they came to the Prophet ﷺ and he gave it to him. He said, take this and feed the 60 poor people. He said, O Prophet of Allah, wallahi, I'm the poorer person in Medina. He said, go and feed your family. So the man ended up going back with the dates, and he didn't do any of this. And that's the mercy of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, this is an evil act, of course. So the expiation has to be done, and this is also to show how to deal with others or one another. It mentioned here one of the mas'ala, if a person had relations with his wife, but forgetfully, he forgot, right? And in that case, there is no expiation for him, you know, because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, رُفِعَ عَمَتِ الْخَطَأُ وَالْنِسْيَانُ وَاسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ. My ummah would not be held accountable by forgetfulness or by falling into a mistake. So a person did know that this today is Ramadan, for example, and you know, so it has to be intentional. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من نسي وهو صائم فأكل أو شرب فليتم صومه فإنما أطعمه الله وسقاه متفق عليه. He said, Prophet ﷺ, من نسي, whoever forgets while fasting, فأكل أو شرب. So he ate or drank, فَلْيُتِمَّ صَوْمَهُ. He should complete his fast. فَإِنَّمَا أَطْعَمَهُ اللَّهُ وَسَقَاهُ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that fed him and gave him the drink. So it does not break the fast. This is not just in fard, as some say. It's fard and nafl, anything. Even if the person ate the whole meal, right, forgetting, and then he remembered, of course, once he remembered, he has to stop, and he continues his fast, and there's no harm, the fast is valid, and he does not have to make the day up or anything like that. وقال لا يزال الناس بخير ما عدوا الفطر. متفق عليه. Mentioned some of the hadith with the sunnah of fasting even. لا يزال الناس بخير. People will continue to be on goodness ما عدوا الفطر as long as they hasten in fasting. They break the fast immediately at Maghrib time. They don't delay it. Right? Like some deviant sects they do. They wait till the middle of the night, like the Rafida. They don't break the fast in Maghrib. And it's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them even more deviants. Right? The sunnah is once the sun sets, you eat immediately. You break your fast. Right? And the Prophet used to break his fast as it would come in the hadith. وَقَالَ تَسَحَّرُوا فَإِنَّ فِي السَّحُورِ بَرَكَةٌ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. Make suhoor because indeed it's barakah, it's blessings. And suhoor is the meal before fajr, and the more it's late, the more it's virtuous. Before fajr and right before fajr. And the end of it is the adhan of fajr, not anything before that. وَقَالَ إِذَا أَفْطَرَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيُفْطِرْ عَلَى تَمْرٍ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَلْيُفْطِرْ عَلَى مَاءٍ فَإِنَّهُ طَهُورٌ رواه الخمس. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, if one of you break his fast, he should break his fast on tamr, on dates. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ, if he didn't find dates, فَلْيُفْطِرْ عَلَى مَاءٍ, he should break his fast on water. فَإِنَّهُ طَهُورٌ, because it's pure. It's not mandatory, but it's definitely something very recommended, health-wise and so on. But the most important thing is that this is the sunnah. This will get rewards this way. So the sunnah is to break the fast like this and then make salah, and then if the person wants to eat afterwards. وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم من لم يدع قول الزور والعمل به والجهل فليس لله حاجة في أن يدع طعامه وشرابه وخير. Say whoever does not stay away from قول الزور, false speech and acting, meaning in a sinful way and ignorance, there is no need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for him to save from eating and drinking. Meaning fasting is not just about eating and drinking to abstain from it, it's about abstaining from what is haram. And fasting is to come al-hujjah ala the fasting person. The hujjah or the evidence is established, irrefutable on those who fast, that they don't have an excuse afterwards to say, I cannot help it but commit sins. You abstain from the necessities of your life throughout the day of Ramadan. So you can't come and say, well, I cannot help it but do these evil acts. Those who smoke, those who do, you know, bad things that breaks the fast, they were able to do it in the month of Ramadan. So there's fasting exposes ourselves, that we are not that weak, that we can be away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the goal of fasting, is to have the level of taqwa and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll stop inshallah at this point. There are more things to be said with the chapter. Because of the salah, then we'll continue inshallah and speak from the spiritual needs.